Hey guys, how are you? It's Jeff Gellman with Solid Canine Training. Just want to put up a short video of one of my 101 clients. We've had one session so far.
What was one of the biggest issues you were struggling with?
Cats stealing everything in our house and trying to swallow items.
Okay, and how many times have you had to go to the emergency room for that?
Five.
Five times?
Yes.
For stealing things?
For stealing things and swallowing them.
Okay, how long was that going on for?
Over a year, since he was a puppy.
So tell me about this since I've seen you in 2 weeks.
We haven't had any incidences. We haven't had any aggression when we've tried to retrieve items from him, and it's been a non-issue.
What did you do to stop it?
I used the e-collar.
How many times?
Once. Now it's a non-issue.
Now, she gave the dog one correction on the remote collar, set the dog up to fail, as you're supposed to, and has not had the problem since. It's only been 2 weeks, but like the problem is done. It was five times the emergency room, but it was a constant daily problem. She also has a calmer dog. And now we're also going to start working on obedience. Now, that was just something to fix the problem. We're also going to be working on household management, obedience training, confidence building, being self-aware of where your dog is. Like, we're going to work on all those things. But to address the immediate need to keep your dog out of the emergency room, that needs to be addressed right now. You don't need to condition the dog on the remote. You don't need to train all kinds of stuff. You literally can address the problem immediately and then move on to that. Now, a lot of folks are going to blame owners. And being a father of seven, owning dogs, having a house, I'm at my office right now where five dogs are all around me. You know, yes, you have to child-proof your home. Yes, you should do some dog-proofing your home. But this concept of like, well, you shouldn't leave kids' toys on the floor. Well, that's just not practical. And really good parents have kids' toys. I mean, here's a great example. Glasses. Okay. Dogs take glasses, cell phones, keys off of counters. That's a coffee table next to my desk. Why can't I leave a set of glasses there? There's a coffee mug, a fork, a little scale. There's hand sanitizer. Like, why can't that be left there? Why can't we just teach our dogs not to touch those things? Why can't there be stuff on the floor for both children and dogs? So, and then also, like, why can't I leave shoes in the hallway? Why can't I leave socks on my bedroom floor? Now, obviously, yes, you should know where your dog is. You should keep your dog out of your bedroom. But dogs jump up onto the washing machine and steal laundry. Dogs get into the laundry basket on the floor in the laundry room that you're either washing, drying, or already has been washed. Like, we also have to live in reality. You can actually correct your dog for stealing things. Like, there's some people that are so, like, we don't live in a sterile environment. And these are not bad people. These are not bad dog owners. There's a lot of blame that goes towards owners. It's like, so it's all the owner's fault. The dog gets a free pass. Meanwhile, you can stop a lot of this stuff with a nice, calm no, and then a consequence with a remote collar. How do you do that? You actually set the dog up for failure. Of course we set up the dog for success. Of course we're gonna do obedience training. Of course we're gonna have rules. Of course we're gonna have structure. Of course we're gonna know where our dog is. Of course we're gonna be self-aware. But they're also dogs. And dogs do stupid stuff. So you have to set the dog up to make a mistake, have a conversation with the dog, that choice was wrong, and then you're done with it. So here's a great example of a client who has been struggling for a year. The dog has gone to the emergency room five times, and problem was solved after one visit with us. This times 1,000 clients. I mean, we worked with 10,000, but like this same story has happened 1,000 times, literally in my training center. with clients that I've worked with, and I can't only imagine how many people have been able to solve these problems outside our training center with watching our social media, because we get the comments and we get the letters all the time. And a lot of times people, they blame owners for everything. They tell everybody it's the owner's fault. It's like, you just don't believe in telling your dog no. That's what it boils down to. Let's get to the root of that opinion you have. You just believe you shouldn't tell your dog no. But you can tell your dog no, and it doesn't ruin the relationship. We hear that a lot. Oh, you'll ruin the relationship. Ruin the relationship? Try going to the vet 5 times. That ruins a relationship. It ruins your bank account. It ruins the health of the dog. So let's stop blaming owners. Sure, owners do need to be accountable. But also, guys, dogs need to be accountable too. Dogs don't get free passes. All right? So this just happened yesterday. Thought I'd take the camera out, get a quick soundbite from a client that I'm actually working with. One correction, problem solved. And of course, we're gonna exercise, eat properly, do obedience, do confidence building, have a management plan. Like, we're gonna do all this stuff. But you can do all that stuff. Your dog can know 50 commands. Your dog can be perfectly trained. Your dog can have great manners. And they still get into the trash. They still jump up on people. Okay? Address the issues as well. And for some reason, everybody wants to avoid that. Just address it. Get it over with. All right? I love you guys. Take care.